Today's stable visit comes from Auchenbowie Home Farm, home of the Gilvear family and, of course, Wee Nigel. Northern Pride, winner of the Colts VDM two-year-old final 2018. And I'm here today to talk to driver Gordon Gilvear, his family and friends about their hopes and dreams for the 2019 season. So I'm here with Gordon Gilvear, and we're starting off with the two-year-olds. So obviously last year we were here with Northern Pride, Wee Nigel, talking about hopes and dreams for Wee Nigel. And as things transpired, things went very, very well for Nigel and Team Gilvear over the course of the season, winning the VDM Colts final at Portmarnock. And this year you've got another two-year-old. This is a rock and roll star. Can you tell us a little bit about your two-year-old hopes for this year?
Yep, this is a rock and roll star. He's a rock and roll dance. Colt, now gelded, challenge accepted, his mother is called. We've purchased the mare in 40 rock and roll star of Harrisburg a couple of years back, and he was foaled over there, and we bred her, and then so he came back at his mother's side sort of thing. So he was broken quite early on last year, about in October time, been training right through the winter, and is training really good. He's eligible to Vincent Delaney, obviously, that's kind of his main goal. I don't have him staked to the one that's early in June. I think he's staked to the second one that's really almost the end of June. I think that's the HRC Futurity. But no, really happy with him. He's a real character. His stable name's Chewy because he chews everything. And this has been tricky this year. He's getting tongue tied, he sticks his tongue out and just leaves it out there the whole time. But no, he's training nice. He's been down at 2:30 kind of speed just now. He's doing everything okay. Happy with him. And hope he has a good season.
And is it a similar case to last year with Nigel? Is Chewy's campaign with the two-year-old quite similar in terms of the races you're looking at?
I think he'll be ready earlier, I would think. As I say, Nigel came back from Harrisburg, didn't get back in the UK till the turn of the year, so he was late getting broken. But as I say, this guy was broken in end of October, so he has 2 months in front of him. 2 months jogging, a lot more work being put under his, you know what I mean, a lot of slow miles into him, so he'll probably be ready a bit earlier, I would say, end of June time.
What would it feel like to win two VDM finals in a row? That would be a pretty big dream, would it not?
Oh, of course it would. I mean, it's getting more difficult all the time to win it. You see how, you know, you look at the breeding and all the entries of the horses, they're fantastic. You know, the winners could come from anywhere, really, at that full list of entries. There's more entries, I think, this year than last year, so you never know. It's difficult even to get a horse there. You know, that's an achievement in itself, so we'll do our best with him and see what happens.
But right now, everything is going all right. He's ticking all the boxes, and he's keeping everyone amused with all his tricks antics around the place.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, now we're with the two-year-old filly, She Be Stunning, a half-sister to She Be Rockin' and She Be Sporty, who you've previously raced as well. Tell us a little bit about She Be Stunning.
She Be Stunning, two-year-old filly, as you say. Mark Kennedy and Karen actually broke her in for us in the winter time there. Did a good job. She's been training really nice ever since. She started to train a couple of miles now, and you know, she's looking the part. She's a first foreclosure we've had, obviously, bred her herself, but. So far she's good. She's got a little bit of an attitude out on the track, but that's alright. Don't mind that with a filly especially. You know, but she's shown some speed, shows a bit of ability, so you know, she's eligible to the VDM later on in the year. And just the SHRC, I think, are the only two that she's staked to, so she'll be a bit later on in the year, hopefully. But I hope she gets there. Shows a bit of talent now. And all going well, we should be in Ireland in August, hopefully.
And in terms of working with fillies and colts and geldings, do you have a preference? Do you prefer working with fillies? Do you prefer working with geldings? Are you happy working with colts? Or is it just a case of if it's a good horse, it's a good horse, it doesn't matter?
Well, a good horse is a good. It's harder to get a good filly, I think. It definitely is. You know, geldings are easier. You know, you don't have to worry about them coming into season. And then, obviously, not being a colt as well, you don't have to worry about them, you know, getting bothered with mares and fillies and getting too excitable and things like that. Geldings are definitely easier, much more manageable. But if you can get a nice filly, it's good as well, because then you obviously you've got the option to go on and breed. But they're definitely harder to come by, I think. So if I had my preference, it would definitely be geldings. But I've not had a real top-end filly for a while. Don't Stop the Party with a nice mare. And maybe, well, since before that, maybe Dilly's Eyes On You right a few years back. So or 2-1, hopefully. So hopefully this girl kind of steps up and takes that.
If all foreclosures were like her, would it be the kind of stallion that you'd be quite happy to have multiple offspring from?
Absolutely. You know, she's beautiful gated and she just floats around the track there. Doesn't need a boot or anything like that. She's never put a foot wrong from day one, really. So that's the first thing you look at. You know, you just tap her on the backside and away she goes. So her attitude's good, her gait's good. That's the first kind of things you look for, I think, a first crop stallion. She's got good conformation and a nice head and that on her. So it's looking good for the foreclosures. I think going to make a nice sire.
Next up we have Sunny, Someone's Fantasy, who viewers will remember as being the Hurricane Pace final winner 2018 and also quite an impressive maiden winner at Musselburgh the year before. So I think the natural leading question here has to be, is Sunny going back to Musselburgh this year?
Absolutely, that's no hiding the fact that's his main goal for this year. He likes the track, the distance. Obviously he's won there, as you said, heat final last year, when he's made there the year before, so he's, I think he's 3 wins out of 4 starts there. And we're in the middle of campaign, I'm getting him ready to go back to have a go at the big one, the famous Musselburgh Pace this year.
And what grade does he start the season as?
He starts at grade 3.
Right, so obviously with there only being one day of racing at Musselburgh as well this year, and they're talking about it being a top number of horses that enter based on the handicap mark, do you need to consider taking him somewhere beforehand to try and get him up the handicap system a little bit?
I don't know really how it's going to work. The split the last 2 years has been grade 3. I think I've sat off the gate, so I was hoping, you know, that would be the case again this year. But I think we'll know more once the season starts, and maybe after Appleby and that, maybe what's racing and what's not, and maybe what's going to happen then. Take it to there.
So, obviously the first part of the season now through May is penalty free. Would we be expecting to see Someone's Fantasy out and racing in May, or is that a little early?
No, I'm going to race him maybe once at least in May. Maybe not the first meeting at York or that. Maybe once at York, we'll take him down there. He needs a big track, he suits him better. We'll give him a race there, possibly. He's not going to go to Appleby, I don't think. It'll be Musselburgh after that. He's definitely the one for the high grade anyway. He lost my mind, raced really good at Musselburgh last year. I know he was only third, but he raced really good. It was only second start of his life. He's a low down in the handicap grade 1 horse, so he'll probably be heading there as well. So those two will be the main kind of two in the handicap, at least for there. We might have a couple of maidens of that. Not just sure yet, see how they shake up. But the way it's looking now would be Someone's Fantasy for the high grade and maybe lose my whole game. My apprentice here as well, been jogging him the last couple of days there, Sandy, my right hand man. So two-seater car, trying to get him fit. So hopefully that's given him the wee extra boost that he needs to go in.
So Sandy, you're the secret weapon. That's what it sounds like. What's it like jogging a horse that's won at Musselburgh? Is he a nice horse to jog?
He's a nice horse. He can be a little bit spooky trying to take off of you sometimes, but most of the time he's pretty relaxed and quite easy on himself.
Not many people can say that the first horse that they were out jogging was a Musselburgh winner or a Sun Beach somewhere as well. So that's pretty high up there for, you know, getting brownie points with your pals when you talk about the horses that you're jogging at home. So we'll keep an eye out for Someone's Fantasy this year, hopefully at Musselburgh and hopefully back in the winner's circle. Right, ladies and gents, now I'm joined by Mr. York, Mr. Musselburgh, Mr. Steward at Corbywood himself, Craig Stevenson. You might recognise him from his multiple posts on social media. For all his
here we are.
This is what Craig calls his horse. This is a horse that nobody else is allowed to jog every day. This is Cheddar, or Lose My Mind. A winner is maiden last year at Pike Hall, very impressively. And also the 3-year-olds at Bells Field as well in 2018. Craig, tell me, how is Cheddar training down this year? You're the man that sits in the bike every day, so you tell me, how's he coming along?
Well, it seems stronger this year, but we'll find out shortly. He won 50% last year. If he wins 50% this year, we'll be doing all right.
And what are the aims? I mean, I spoke to Gordon earlier on, he did mention perhaps the low grades at Musselburgh, but obviously Gordon's also said to me that you can't tell me what the plan is because you don't know what the plan is yet.
Right.
But in your mind, where would you like to see Cheddar racing this year?
Well, I'm going to try and get a bit early at the penalty free to try and get a race somewhere. Either York or Corbywood, depends what starts. He's not ready for the early meetings at Tuprince or York. But we'll just, anywhere, just see how good he comes down this year. He never made the race as a two-year-old last year. We had him going quite good. Gave him four races and finished him for this year. Finished a good mark. So we'll see how good he gets. Musselburgh, it'd be great to win the Musselburgh low grade 2 years in a row, but we'll see. He ran well at Musselburgh last year. He got shuffled back and finished third, beat a head in the head, which wasn't a bad race. He gives you everything, eh? He's a bit cheeky.
He definitely looks a little bit cheeky. And in terms of when you're jogging him, is there any kind of quirks about him, or is he quite straightforward, nice to sit behind?
Yeah, you've got to let him walk.
That's him on your foot.
You've got to let him walk the first half lap. If you don't, he'll pull your arms out. Once he's walking, gets jogs away in his own speed, he's okay. Nice horse to work with, but he'll bite you every day.
So is that him? That is that his way of saying that he doesn't really like you that much, but he can't get rid of you? Because, like I said, you seem to be the only person that jogs him.
I'm the only person who goes on him. He can't get rid of me. We Stephen tried to get. He got a couple of shots from when I was on holiday, so he looked after him well during the winter. We Stephen. But as long as he wins, it doesn't matter who's on him.
I mean, the ultimate goal really you're looking at is hopefully go to Musselburgh for the low grades, but. I mean, would you say that he's a hard track horse, a grass track horse? Is he quite versatile that you think he could race anywhere?
To be fair, he's never raced in Corbywood.
He's quite a big horse. He is quite a big horse. Do you think he'd be able to handle Corbywood no problem at all?
Oh yes, he's worked round there twice, I think. Eh? But we had a plan last year, eh? And it worked out okay. Ireland, he ran poor in Ireland. We're disappointed. We thought he'd run a big race, but. We'll see. We'll keep him to. We'll try and get there in a couple of races, and we'll keep him to Appleby, then Musselburgh first. Then we'll see what is left in the calendar for him. Eh?
See what the rest of the season holds. So this is it. Now this is committed to video. So what happens now is it lose my mind. We'll not race at any of these tracks that Craig has mentioned. This will be another decoy, like the decoy at Pike Hall, where I thought someone's fantasy was going to romp in, and it was, in fact, Lose My Mind, who was the surprise winner in my mind on the day. And we'll see what happens with 2019. But no matter what happens, we'll be able to hear Craig in the background shouting, come on, Cheddar, the definitely. Big cheese.
Definitely.
Okay, next up now, we've got Dream Fair Adele. Gordon's joined by owner Shirley Dixon as well. Reluctantly, but now an absolute natural standing there, and Adele's decided to prick up her ears as well. So this is a three-year-old unraced, full sister to Mr. Brightside and half sister to Easy Company. Anybody watching this will remember Easy Company, multiple race winner over the last couple of seasons, Mr. Brightside as well before that. So tell us a little bit about Dream Fair Adele.
Well, she is a three-year-old Dream Fair Volvo filly, as you've said, unraced yet. A homebred 1-8 hours that Stuart and Shirley bought off us last year. Took a liking to her when she was training last year. Acquired her. So we're just training her back. She's been in training now, I think, about 8 weeks, something like that, 7-8 weeks. Started to go a couple of slow miles. She's going really well. As you say, she's a full sister to Mr. Brightside, who's a horse that campaigned and Easy Company, a half sister to him, the one that we raised. She's a kind of, I would say, a mixture of the two horses. Mr. Brightside was really kind of fine, like an Easy Company. It was more a big, rugged horse. I'd say she's a mixture of the two. But no, she's going really nice at the minute. I'm hopeful she makes a nice race horse for Stuart and Shirley for this season.
And in terms of her season, obviously first she'll need to qualify. I'd imagine that would be our local track, Corbywood. But going on from there then, is there a plan in terms of her first season campaign, or is it very much just a case of see what happens?
No, just a case, as you say, see what happens. She's eligible only to the SHRC three-year-old race. We didn't stake her in any other races. We don't want to put too much pressure on her. We'll just take her time there and let her tell us where she needs to go. We probably will qualify Corbywood, I would imagine, as you said, and then take it from there, see where she fits, see what kind of calibre she is. That'll depend on where she goes to race.
Very much hoping, I guess, at this stage that she is somewhere along the lines of Mr. Brightside and Easy Company kind of quality, multiple race winners, hard and grass track. So hopefully she's as versatile and as a prolific winner as well as those two of her brothers. And Shirley, what are your hopes? As an owner, what are your hopes for Adele?
I would just like to see her racing and have a bit of fun with her.
That's what it's all about, a bit of fun. There we go. We wish Dreamfair Adele the best of luck when she reaches the racetrack.
Thank you.
And here we have Puissant Hanover, another American imported horse here. And this mare, she raced last year with success. Logan drove her to a couple of wins, and then, as I like to give a bit of stick for at the Murdoch weekend, then when she won heat and final at the low grade handicap on the Saturday, Logan had actually given you the drives. And it's something I think perhaps he might not live down. But Puissant Hanover now, starting this season, with those couple of wins under her belt, what's the plan for her?
The plan is to, she's a grade three now, so she'll try and get a race in the penalty free. Hopefully maybe try and win one there. She'll go to Appleby in the spring, and then we'll make her eligible for the Corbywood Mare Series race after that, and we hope to race her in every leg almost of that race her there, although she won't travel too far. She has issues tying up now, that's fully, you just got to be kind of careful where how you train her, where you race her, be kind of kind to her. But that's the plan with her. Appleby in the spring and then the Mare Series after that, and just race away. We'll probably race to the end of this year, and she'll probably look to breed probably next year in the spring.
So she's been kept in training this year. As you mentioned there, there's a Mare Series at Corbywood. We talked last year with Brian about Don't Stop the Party entering, and she raced with success in that as well. Don't Stop the Party now, not in training this year, so you're looking then to bring another mare out for that series. Is that a reason why you would maybe keep these mares in training that extra season?
Absolutely, definitely. It's a good opportunity for them. You know, prize money's good. They get to race against their own kind. The races, you know, mix up a wee bit preferred, and then they trail, all these kind of different things. It's definitely, she probably, with the opportunity this year, especially maybe to breed to Sweet Lou or something like that, this mare probably would have been bred this year, and not even been put in training, but we thought with this series going, we'll give her a go in that, see if she can step up against the older horses, see if she gets on there, and then maybe breed her again next year.
It just adds like a little bit extra to their CV if they can pick up wins in these races. In addition as well, the Stagby Broodmares races, there's two of them at Corbywood this year with a final at York as well on sale day. So there's plenty of opportunities to be racing a mare this year, and she's obviously then eligible for all of those, and hopefully, you know, really competitive in them as well. The other thing that I wanted to ask you as well in Logan's absence is, with you being the sort of the last successful driver on board her at the back end of last year, who takes the drive now for 2019? Will it revert back to Logan, or is he just going to leave you in charge?
I think it will revert back to Logan now. It's up to it's his decision. He does all the work, gets up early, comes off a night shift and jogs her, or gets up early before his day shifts and jogs her. He's got her and another three-year-old filly that he trains himself, so it's entirely up to him what he wants to do. I'll be there waiting if he decides he's had enough of. No, I hope he sticks with her and rides her, because she's a nice mare, she's easy to drive. You know, in that mare series there, hopefully he'll stick with her and get a couple of wins in there, it'd be good for him.
And now we found our way round to Wee Nigel, Northern Pride, winner of the VDM Colts Final at Port Marnock last year. And obviously a video superstar. He's featured in a couple of videos now, floating around on social media. Tell me, Gordon, how is Nigel training down, ready for the start of his three-year-old season?
Good, he's fine. Couldn't be any better. Had a good long winter off, obviously. Started back early February. And he's been going training miles in the last couple of weeks. And so far, so good. He's a little bit more aggressive this year, as you would expect. He knows what the game is now. Not just not a wee baby anymore. He's grew a little bit, I would say. He's never going to be a big horse. He's maybe a little longer, a little bit taller, but he's not really thickened out much. But I'm not too worried about that. He was fast enough the way he was. So really looking forward to this year. He'll maybe look for a penalty free race early May, maybe Corbywood or York or something like that early with them, and then we'll be going straight to all the kind of three-year-old races. I haven't put them into Appleby, we're going to skip that one. The first big three-year-old race will be early June, Turf Prince, I think the North Wales sort of two-year-old race, I think that's the first one, the one of one. We'll be there, back to Turf Prince again for the HRC Derby, he's got the SHRC three-year-olds, Ireland, you know, loads of all the big kind of ones.
So we're doing a lot of travelling again this year, up and down the country. Hopefully, most of the main events then as a three-year-old, and like you say, back to Ireland as well for the three-year-olds there. Of all of the ones that you can win of the three-year-old season, obviously, you know, a win is a win, but of all of those ones that he is state for and eligible for, which one is, on a personal level, the one that you would like to win the most?
I wouldn't say in the three-year-old races I really have a personal favourite, to be honest with you. I think they're all nice. I would like to go back to Ireland and win again. Obviously, winning the VDM last year was fantastic. A great experience. Just anything you can... I mean, you travel away from home, I think, far, and manage to win a race like that, it makes it a wee bit even more special. So if I could pick one, I would probably like to go and win the Oakley Stud three-year-old race in Ireland kind of later on in the year.
I think that would probably elevate you, your celebrity status as well with the Americans, because I think Roger Houston and Heather Vitale were fairly impressed with the Gilvear family and their celebrations after winning the two-year-olds last year. I think Nigel went straight to the hearts of many people. And like you say, he has grown a little bit, but I think I can still get away with calling him Wee Nigel this year as opposed to Big Nigel.
Oh, definitely. Never be Big Nigel, that's for sure.
but the news is, for anybody watching this, is that Nigel's training down well, and hopefully, fingers crossed, we will see him at all of the big events this year as a three-year-old and back in the winner's circle. Go on, Nigel.